Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen.
Amen.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, give us grace to cast away the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Now in the time of this mortal life in which your Son Jesus Christ came to visit us in great humility, then in the last day, when he shall come again in his glorious majesty to judge both the living and the dead, we may rise to the life immortal. Through him who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
A reading from Isaiah. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence. As when fire kindles brushwood, and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, so that the nations may tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down, the mountains quaked at your presence. From age past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in your ways. But you were angry and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you. For you have hidden your face from us. You have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider we are all your people. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us say together Psalm 80, printed in your service booklet. Hear, O Shepherd of Israel, leading Joseph like a flock.
Shine forth, you that are enthroned upon the cherubim, in the presence of Ephraim, Benjamin, and Manasseh. Stir up your strength and come to help us. Restore us, O God of our hosts. Show the light of your countenance, and we shall be saved. O Lord God of hosts, how long will you be angered despite the prayers of your people? You have fed them with the bread of tears. You have given them bowls of tears to drink. You have made us the denizens of our neighbors, and our enemies laugh us to scorn. Restore us, O God of hosts. Show the light of your countenance, and we shall be saved. Let your hand be upon the man of your right hand, the son of the man you have made so strong for yourself. And so will we never turn away from you. Grant us life that we may call upon your name. Restore us, O Lord God of hosts. Show the light of your countenance, and we shall be saved.
A reading from 1 Corinthians. Grace to you and peace from God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you because of the grace of God that has been given you in Christ Jesus. For in every way you have been enriched in him, in speech and knowledge of every kind. Just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened among you, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will also strengthen you to the end, that you may be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful. By him you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "In those days, after that suffering, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light. And the stars will be falling from heaven and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer's near. So also when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near, at the very gates. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey. When he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his own work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening or at midnight or at cockcrow or at dawn, or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
The sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light and the stars will be falling from the heavens and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. And then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. And that poses an interpretive challenge. As all those things that Jesus described, the sun and moon dimming and the stars falling from the sky and the Son of Man coming in the clouds, as they are described literally here in this excerpt from the Gospel of Mark, they have not happened. What do we make of that? We could just say, well, he's wrong, you know. But, you know, we're here in church, right, as Christians, so supposedly we will not immediately write him off as being incorrect. Perhaps a better question is, in what way is he right? These sayings that I just read from the Gospel of Mark, they're in the genre of apocalyptic literature. They come from the 13th chapter of the Gospel of Mark, which is known as the Little Apocalypse, which is just an adorable name. I think the apocalypsito, you know, and an apocalypse it's a formal genre of writing in the ancient world. The word genre apocalypse literally means to reveal or uncover. And the goal of apocalyptic literature is to uncover something, to reveal something. And it does that through a particular set of literary tools, fantastical imagery, such as the sun and the moon dimming and the stars falling from the sky and a man coming in the clouds. It does that through descriptions of insiders and outsiders and some people chosen and other people not chosen, as we read here of the angels gathering the elect from the ends of the earth to the ends of, and gathering them to the ends of heaven. The Christian and Jewish apocalyptic literature often refers to the Son of Man, although the genre is not limited to those traditions. So that's what's going on here. This is apocalyptic. Then what is it trying to uncover? What does this little apocalypse reveal to us? Well, there's three parts of this reading. The first one I just described, this vision of the sun and the moon and the stars and the Son of Man. And a big message there, no matter what the details as it is told might be, the big message here seems to be God is going to show up, right? And not just show up, but show up in a big way and then be there for us, to hold us close, to gather us together. Now, who is the us in this story? Who are the elect? We don't know. Jesus didn't say. Is it Christians? Is it moral, righteous people? Is it just, as I might be inclined to say, is it everybody, right? Is God's grace so broad that no one could possibly be left behind? I don't know. It doesn't say. And we should beware always of trying to impose our assumptions onto the words of Jesus. We just don't know. What we know is that God's coming. God has promised in this story to be right around the corner. And that's what we find also in the lesson of the fig tree that Jesus tells. He says, you know, when you see a fig tree and the leaves are starting to come out, that it's almost summer. Things are about to happen. And in the same way, when you see these things that I am describing to you, something big is about to happen. It is imminent. It is just right around the corner on the edge of our world, getting ready to just break in. And if we are to take the first part seriously, then also to break stuff, right? To break the moon and the stars. And third, this last saying in the lessons that we put together this morning, it's a story of a man who goes away and leaves his servants in charge. And he gives each of them a job to do. And he tells them, keep watch, stay awake. And the commands here, the imperatives are, you know, work, wait, watch, stay awake. Now, again, a literal reading of this isn't going to make any sense, right? If this master is Jesus telling us to stay awake, 2,000 years later, the human body still has a biological need for sleep. So clearly, this is something else going on. Perhaps the idea here is that if God is going to show up in a big way, as we saw, and if that arrival is imminent, as we see in the story of the fig tree, then this is simply telling us, so keep looking. Keep your eyes and your ears open for God and stay on the job. Keep doing the job that was assigned to you. What's the job? Again, Jesus doesn't say. And again, we should beware of imposing our assumptions onto what Jesus says. But then again, if it is Jesus we're talking about, I think that there are some things that it is safe to assume, right? I think it is safe to assume, what is our job? Love God, love your neighbor. I mean, he says, this is it. This is what it boils down to. So that's part of it. We got to keep that up, to try our best to make this world more like the kingdom that Jesus has come and proclaimed, where the least are the greatest, where the rejected are the most beloved, and where sacrificing oneself leads to the fullest life. Keep that up. Don't quit. Now, why read this during Advent? I mean, God did not choose this reading for the first Sunday of Advent. The church calendar and the cycle, the lectionary cycle of 3 years of Bible readings devised by human beings. So how is this helpful? I think because these apocalyptic passages here are pointing us towards something important about the incarnation that we celebrate at the end of Advent, the birth of God in Jesus Christ. Not just the birth of the baby Jesus, but also the fact that the infinite divine comes and inhabits this world. It's a really weird thing. It's a really radical thing. It is disruptive. It's disordering. This notion of incarnation is as chaotic as the stars falling from the sky. And it is telling us this image, it is telling us what all those TV specials are also trying to tell us, the true meaning of Christmas. But the true meaning of Christmas here is not just that God loves us and came to be with us, but that in so doing, God has flipped the tables over in every way. We are part of a movement that is supposed to be constantly disrupting the world, embracing things that are uncomfortable and saying yes to things that the world says no to. That's what God has done in the incarnation by being one of us. That is what Jesus did in his life, in his words, and in his actions. And it's our job too. The late Ed Koch was mayor of New York from 1979 to 1987. And he was known in his daily life to be out on the streets of New York and to walk up to his constituents and say, "How am I doing?" It's a gutsy thing to say as the mayor of New York. But it's a question that we might well ask ourselves as well in Advent. How am I doing? How am I doing at the job of defying the expectations of the world around us? How am I doing at breaking down the barriers between myself and other people? How am I doing at pushing the world to embrace people who've been rejected? When I was a school chaplain, it was pretty easy to come up with examples of ways that we could do that within the highly structured life of my students when they were on campus. Right? How am I doing? Well, everybody goes to lunch. Who do you sit with? Everybody goes to class. Who do you choose to pair up with or ask to be in your study group? They're really easily structured opportunities to do that work that God has given us of disrupting the order around us and doing something in the way that God would do instead. Adult life is less structured than the life of a high school, but it is equally full of opportunities to do that kind of work. And the workplace has just as much of a social hierarchy as any other place. So how do we operate within it? Who do we embrace? Who do we listen to? Who do we take seriously? Who do we ignore? Or we may consider service workers, people in grocery stores, pharmacies, restaurants, other jobs, who are, for the most part, underappreciated and underpaid. How do we treat them in our daily lives? Jesus tells us, stay awake. Stay awake to their needs. Stay awake to their dignity. And stay awake to their belovedness. When we do that sort of work, we are foreshadowing what Jesus is describing in this little apocalypse, this radical vision of the Son of Man crashing into the world on the clouds as the sun and moon and stars go out. This shaking disorientation and then reorientation to a new way of living. And we're participating in that. You see, that's what Advent is preparing us for, not just the beautiful, comforting image of a child being born in Bethlehem, but also the radical and unsettling image of a God who is first and foremost living in the weak and is always there, waiting to be revealed to us if we will look. So we keep at our work and we keep our eyes peeled in the expectation that we might see God at any minute, at any time. And we stay awake. Let us affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Thank you.
Prayers of the People is Form 3. Father, we pray for your Holy Catholic Church.
That we all may be one.
Grant that every member of the church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons.
That they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed, especially Bob Petito and Jean Williams, eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
For all people struggling with COVID-19, for all those who care for them and for their loved ones. O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Let us pray the words our Savior Christ has taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Please join in a prayer for spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the Blessed Sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire you in my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. As though you were already there, I embrace you and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Also with you.
Live without fear. Your Creator has made you holy, has always protected you, and loves you as a mother. Go in peace to follow the good road. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you this day and remain with you always. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Let us bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.